us.
Yes.
I'm going to save that last song for the end. We're both having our worship team.
Awesome.
I'm going to sit here. God is so good. Just to be able to hear the voice of the Lord and when we hear the mountains to move. Some of you have heard through Facebook that I've been very ill. We're going to see the Lord move again.
That's right. That's right.
I am confident that I will walk in healing again.
That's right.
And I am confident that I still stand and my family stands in the promises of God. Can't help but get a little sentimental that it's been a challenge this last 3 months. 2 years, 2.5 years ago, God came into this very house and I had a supernatural experience with the Lord. I am completely healed from asthma for those 2 years. And I am not a rain cloud, but I am at nature sometimes, just very real. And I said, until it lasts, or however long that healing will last, I will be confident and be assured that I will bless the name of the Lord the same.
That's right.
Whether it continues or it doesn't, I will enjoy that healing. But I know that I walk in the favor of God. For those of you that have prayed for me, yes, and have walked me through this time, I assure you that the moon phase does not mean I am into astrology. It just means I'm swollen and that it will soon go away, yeah, as we get through this time. The mountain does have to move.
That's
I walk
right
in obedience. I am still standing in his favor with my family,
yes,
and those that have come alongside of us. We thank you for your prayers.
Yes.
And we have to be able to challenge and stand when the enemy says no. And today I want to be able to drive home that thought of the enemy and drive it out in your minds that when the enemy comes to supplant and to attack with the thought of the enemy and say, you are not going to move forward, to tell the mountain to move. How many of you have been in that place where the enemy comes to attack and say, you know what, you're not going to move forward. I'm coming to rob you from the place that I have for you. Well, today I'd like to share with you about a little woman called Jael, who was of a giant slayer's family. And though many people think that she was small, Jael was very powerful. Her name means
right,
strength of God. I named my daughter after her. Her name is Jisali Jael. And she means pledged unto the Lord. And Jael means strength of God. Spell it correctly, Y-A-E-L, and it means strength of God. Spell it J-A-E-L, and it means stubborn as a goat. So if you call her Y-A-E-L, it means strength of God. And the way you name your kids will dictate the way they plan their life with God. Action speaks louder than words. I want to talk to you about action speaking louder than words. Many times we give all of this lip action to God. And we say, God, I will never leave your side. God, I will never, never, ever, ever do this. But the moment that trials come our way, we tail out of there and we give up. We surrender. When it gets hard and the going gets tough, we shut up. We shut down. And I'm going to tell you that Job went through this. People go through this. We go through this. Like David went through this. Jael had to show up through this. Different people in the Bible went through this. So if you think you're the last poke in the desert going through this, you're not. Let me tell you something. It's the way trials come. If you're in the valley, that's where you're being forged at. The valley is the place that your dream being trained at. It's where your perspective is being trained so that you can see a higher up. It's where you, where giant slayers are trained. Can I tell you that this is where God has you at? If you're in a valley, let me tell you something. My daddy always taught me, valley is where giant slayers are trained.
Come on, that's right.
It's where you learn how to climb up a mountain.
Come on,
it's where you
right
learn where how to go into a creek.
That's
it's where
right
you learn how to cross over.
That's right.
It's where you learn where the rocks how to climb on
that's
the edge.
Right. That's right.
If you're in your valley, it's where you're learning to be trained.
Come on, that's right.
Don't be afraid of your valley.
That's right. Amen.
It's where you're being forged at. In the time of Jael, I'm going to share you a little bit of history about Jael. In the days of Jael, Judges 5:6, it says, the days of Shamgar and the sons of Anath. In the days of Jael, and the highways were deserted, and the travelers walked on along the byways, in the days where giants ruled the land, and the sons of Anath. And Jael comes from a legacy of giant slayers, and the Canaanites and Caleb. Bro, she had some pretty awesome legacy. From Caleb, Mad Dog Caleb, okay? So, and so she knew her descendants. She knew who she was. And Jael comes from that legacy. 5:14, from Ephraim were those, the roots were in Elimelech. And just like today, the compromise of spiritual blending with the enemy that occurs. Elimelech represents those who attack the weak and the tired, and they were weakened. Weaken the tribe of a double portion. How many of you have been attacked?
That's right.
Your double portion has been attacked.
Come on. That's right.
I know I've been attacked.
That's right.
My family has
that's
been attacked. Right. Our church has been attacked.
That's right.
Because you know what? If you can attack your leaders are attacked, my sheep get attacked.
That's right.
And let me tell you something. But you know what? I serve a God that's greater than that.
That's
I serve
right.
a God that I prepared my kids.
Come
I
on.
Said, you know what? If God decides to take mom home, you're going to serve because I'm going to make a place in heaven for you. Just like Billy Graham, when he went out, he said, guess what? There's a rumor that I've been taken, but it's a lie because I'm celebrating in heaven. And I told my mom, I told my kids, I told the people that I mentor, if God decides to take me, don't you dare get bitter. You know why? Because I'll be making a room in heaven for you. I'll be making a celebration in heaven. You know why? Because it's the God that goes before me. Don't you dare get angry, because I'm making room. But you know what? Our responsibility is not to get angry. Our responsibility is to say, guess what? We celebrate in the heavens that we serve a God that's so great. We can't dictate. I remember when my son Cyrus died. He said, will you still bless me if I keep him? And I had to stop. And I said, yes, God. I'll still bless your name the same. And I prepare my children that way. Why? Because life is never guaranteed. But one thing is guaranteed, that our obedience is assured under our feet. That my knees are assured. That when I train my children, I train them for war. That when I train my spiritual children that I mentor, that they are ready to take the place that God assures them with. So when you feel that you've been threatened, that compromise settles in, that your double portion is being threatened, you say, no, you have no place. Mountain, move. You have to move. You have no authority here. That's your portion, that you can say, mountain, move. You don't have to move the mountain. God moves the mountain for you. You see, sometimes we think as Christians, we have to move that mountain. That's not your responsibility.
That's right.
Moses didn't part the sea. Jesus parted the sea. God parted the sea. He just extended the thing that was in front of him. He just wants you to extend your hand, bend your knee, the very thing, utter your voice. He didn't say, part the sea. He just said, tell it to move. Speak the authority which I've given it to you. Sometimes we forget the authority that God has given to us.
That's right.
We're afraid to tell sickness to leave. We're afraid to tell finances that are sick to move.
That's right.
We're afraid to declare what God has spoken over us because we're afraid of the threat that stands in our way. Because of the compromise and the blending in society today, it's okay to drink in your church. It's okay to have casual sex. It's okay. It's okay. Compromise. Little gray room area. I'm sorry to tell you there's no gray room in area in heaven.
That's right. Amen.
It's either black or it's white. It's hell or it's heaven. There is no gray room area. If you're waiting for your gray tone area, there is no gray room.
That's right.
And I'm going to tell you today, if it offends you, then let it heal you before it offends you.
That's right.
Come on.
Come on.
It's the truth. Amen.
There is a double portion waiting for you, but if you want a double portion, you got to stop the spirit of compromise.
Jesus.
Don't allow compromise in your home. See, Jael knew something about compromise. In Judges 4:17, however, Syria had fled away on foot to the tent of Jael, wife of Heber and the Canaanite. For there was a peace between Jabin, the king of Hazar, and the house of Heber the Kenite. Heber the Kenite was her husband. They had peace. You see, kind of like churches today. They have peace between enmity in the world. You know what? It's okay. We'll have self-compromise. If we, you know what, we can have a little bit of worldly music. It's nothing wrong with that. You know, it doesn't, you know, I don't mind worldly music in my house as long as it's not too much cussing. I don't mind. You can have a worldly girlfriend as long as you're not sleeping together. You know, you can have, it's okay to be unevenly yoked. You know what, even if she's a Christian and you don't have the same call, that's okay. No, it's not okay. You know why? Because it's still disobedient. But she's a Christian. But does she have the same call as God in your life? Or are you dragging her along? Does she have a noose around her neck? Does he have a noose around his neck? Do you have the same calling? See, some compromises come in different ways. But we don't think about them. Unevenly yoked doesn't mean because they're a Christian or not a Christian. Unevenly yoked means you're not on the same road that God is calling you to be on. The same destiny that God is calling you to be on. See, compromise comes in so many different ways, but we don't realize what God is calling us to do. If you're called to serve in the mission field and somebody else is called to serve in the States, you're on two different paths. Then what happens? You're unevenly yoked and one is going to get torn and the other one's not going to complete the call of God. Well, gee. Well, isn't sharing nice? That's not the kind of God who wants you to share. You're compromising the call and forfeiting what God has called you to do. But sometimes we want to be so politically correct not to offend others. Politically correct to say, you know what, it's okay, a little compromise here, a little leaven here. It spoils the whole pot. Stop compromising in your life. You know what, I have a heart problem, so I'm going to drink a glass of wine every night. And that glass of wine becomes habitual. You know what? I have a gossip problem, so I'm going to tell a little secrets here and there every night. And before you know it, you've destroyed somebody's life.
That's right.
You know, these are things that I have a lateness problem, and before you know it, you never show up to church on time. And you give up your seat.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I have a depression problem, and I just missed one service after the other, and you lost your place. You know, I've seen so many times people tell me, I'm sick and I just can't get to church. You're sick, you need to be in church. That's where God heals you at. That's where he shows up. I remember my kids one time, they told me, man, I'm sick, I can't go to church. Well, get dressed, that's where we're going. You know, sickness is where Jesus shows up most.
That's right.
It's where he
amen.
Says, you put a demand and anointing and I heal you.
Yes, amen.
You know what? I don't know if you can still see my bruises, but I had more than 12 IVs last week and blood gases, and I was bruised, and I said, Lord, I know my body is hurting, but I'm going to keep trekking. And it's where my faith was tested.
Right.
I was angry. I was like, Lord, you took your promises back. The devil came to lie to me and tell me, you are going to repeat this. You're going to leave your kids. You're not going to. And I literally was hearing the voice of the enemy telling me, that's it. And then the Lord came and smacked me up. The Holy Spirit said, really, you're going to believe the lies of the enemy after everything I've done for you? And he said, get out of bed and sin no more. Because your thought pattern is sin to me. He said, you need to arise and think the way I've called you to think. You are an overcomer.
That's right.
Amen. And I said, Lord, forgive me, because if I've overcome, then I've overcome this thinking pattern. And whether it's to believe that I prepare for those that go before me, then I'm going to go out preparing. But I will not shrink back from what you called me to do.
That's right.
And this is what Jael did. She didn't shrink back. There was a time of war, and this guy came into her tent, bro. He didn't know what he was doing. He thought that he could bring compromise into her tent. He said, here I'm going to find some peace, because I know her homeboy here, her husband, he doesn't stand up for what's, he doesn't really speak up against anything. He'll He'd be like, yeah, sure, you're a friend. Yeah, come in, it's okay. So here he comes, Heber the Canaanite, and it's peace between Jabin the king of Hazor and the house of Heber the Canaanite. Just because those who close you makes peace with the enemy doesn't mean that you must do so also. So just because those that are close to you make peace with the enemy doesn't mean that you have to.
That's right.
Okay? So take initiative. I want you to take initiative. You have to take initiative to be able to take out the enemy. Sometimes we're afraid. You know, Jael, she was little. This king was big. He came into her tent. And this is how it goes in Judges 4, 17, 21. And Jael went out to meet Syria and said to him, turn aside, my Lord, turn aside to me, and do not fear. And when he had turned aside, the Lord aside to me, do not fear. And when he had turned aside with her into the tent, she covered him with a blanket. And then he said with her in the tent, with a blanket, then he said to her, please give me a little water to drink, for I am thirsty. She opened a jug of milk. I have better for you. I'll give you some milk. That's what she told him, right? I am thirsty. So she opened a jug of milk and said to her, stand at the door of the tent, and if any man comes and inquires you, say, is there any man here? You shall say no. Then Jael, Heber's wife, took a tent peg and took a hammer in her hand and went softly to him and drove the peg into his temple. It went down into the ground, for he was fast asleep and weary, so he died. Bro. He said, will you cover my sin? Will you protect me? Can I trust you?
She said, sure.
I got you, bro. I got you. Can you give me some water? She goes, I got better for you. I'm going to give you some milk. She gave him some milk. She led him into the tent. She stood guard. When he was fast asleep and he thought that he got this, she didn't announce that she was going to drive him out, that she was going to take him out. You know, sometimes as Christians, we want to announce that we're so Christian, that we're, no, you can't be here. You can't do that. That I'm Christian. That's not acceptable. You don't have to announce your Christianity like that and show it and all pronounce it that it's so distasteful. Sometimes you can offer them milk so that they can digest it and feel assured and secure, that you are so secure of your Christianity that it brings a trustful place, that you can raise your hand to the enemy and drive it right through the thought pattern, that you can nail it through, that the enemy cannot rise up against, and you get victory over that war. But she did it quietly. How many of you can do it quietly? That it's so assured that it never rises again. That the enemy's thought pattern cannot come into your home to bring compromise. That's your job. And say, I take it out. I rise against it. The Bible says that she did it softly, but she did it straight to the ground with power. I love that. It took some strength for her to do that, you know. Mm-hmm. Become the instrument of God. It says that most blessed among the women of Jael, the wife of Heber the Canaanite, blessed among the women in the tent. He asked for water, she gave him milk. Sorry, I read that already. And it sank and fell still a feet where it sank, and he fell dead. You are a real threat to the enemy. You have to know that you are a real threat to the enemy. You know, the reason why you get attacks is because you're a real threat. If you're not getting attacked, you're not a real threat. Sometimes we wonder why we're getting attacked. Sometimes we wonder, you know, so many times I hear Christians say, I want to give up. I can't. My life is not, this Christianity thing is not working. I just feel like I'm so tired. You know, you always hear, even David said, why downcast all my soul? And he, at the time, had to rejoice in the Lord. He had to rejuvenate his spirit. But you know, one of the times that he had to find his joy again, the reason why was because when kings were at war, he did not go to war. He forgot to go to war. He chose not to go to war. So if you choose not to go to war, what happens? You lose your place. So a lot of oftentimes we forget what happens. Practice makes perfect as Christians. We have to put on the spiritual warfare.
That's right.
And so oftentimes if you people say, if you follow your passion, you'll find your place. No. If you only follow your passion, you will lose your place. You have to know your purpose. You can't just be willy-nilly and follow passion, because passion will blow out. You have to know your purpose. My purpose is to be a woman of God, and therefore my passion will awaken.
That's right.
My purpose will allow my passion to take place. You see, my dad often tells me, pain births passion and passion births purpose. But he never told me, follow your passion. He says, your purpose will allow it to birth. But you, if you don't know your purpose, you will never, never, never be able to keep passion alive.
That's right.
And so you have to know that there's a purpose inside of you.
Yes. Amen.
And that purpose that stands, because passion will die out.
That's right.
And it is your job to keep that passion alive. Whether you are sick, whether you are tested, whether you are tried, it is your job to keep that passion alive. David had to find that passion. He had to say, why downcast my soul? Come on, rejuvenate.
Amen.
The woman with the issue of blood, she had to get up and go to her healing. Mm. Sometimes it's going to cost you to get up and go to that place.
Yes.
Pastor Danny, my dad last week talked about knowing your epicenter. But guess what? You got to know where it's at.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
It takes an action. Actions speak louder than words.
Right.
It's going to cost you something.
That's right.
It cost Jael to have some hupomone, some endurance, some strength. She had to get some boldness. Can you imagine this big guy, he's a king, comes into her tent.
Come on.
And Jael, the Bible says she was big in stature. You know, she was of the giant, descendants of giants, but a few generations removed, you know, giant slayers. But can you imagine? He's sleeping. She had to put a peg through this man's head. And I'm weirdo, so my hands are like shaky. Can I imagine just her, like, you know, shaking in fear? But some Holy Ghost anger came over her.
Jeez.
And she said, you are not going to come into compromise into my home. You're not going to take my children. You're not going to take my husband. You're not going to take anything that belongs to me. Sometimes you have to drive out the thoughts of the enemy.
That's right.
And sometimes that's the hardest thing for us to do, even when it comes against ourselves. We're in our war room. Mm. Sometimes we only go into our war room when there's a war.
Mm. That's right.
How about on a daily basis?
That's right.
We forget to abide in that place.
That's right. Good girl. Awesome.
So the hammer represents the word of the Lord that breaks chains. Jeremiah 23:29. It is not my word like fire that says to the Lord, like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces. She raised the hammer. That peg represents the hammer of the Lord. The right hand represents God's divine justice.
Mm-hmm.
Psalms 138:7. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, he will revive you and stretch out your hand against the wrath of my enemies, and your right hand will save me. He is mighty to save, and he is always on time.
Amen.
Guys, he will never leave you or forsake you. No matter who he takes from you, no matter what he takes from you, he will never abandon you. God is a God that is faithful to save. No matter what you've been through, no matter what you've lost, he is a God that shows up on time. No matter who's abandoned you, no matter who has spoken about you, no matter how much haterade or haterade they have showed to you, he is a God that shows up. Let them keep drinking haterade, because you know what? You're still standing. I remember Cyrus, when I used to punish him when he was a little boy, he used to say, I'm like, you sit in that timeout chair. And he used to say, Mommy, I'm sitting, but on the inside, I'm standing. So you yell out to the enemy, on the inside, I'm standing.
Amen.
And you tell your enemies,
Amen.
I am standing in the name of Jesus Christ. And though I God will give you favor, and you will stand your turn long after they are gone. Number three, God will lay the enemies at your feet. Psalms 8:6, you have made to have dominion over the works of your hands, and you have put all things under your feet.
Come on, that's right.
The Bible says that all things are under your feet. Right, you are a real threat. Sometimes you think you don't have the power.
That's good.
You know what? God has given you the power.
That's
it says that even if you have the faith of a mustard seed. I remember people used to tell me, Erica, you don't have enough faith to be healed. You don't have enough faith. That's just, I said, my brother, have you seen a crumb on the floor? It's the size of a mustard seed.
That's right.
And last time I checked, I said, God said, if I had that much faith, I could be healed.
Right, that's right.
Maybe your faith needs to increase.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that I have that much faith.
Come on.
I know that maybe you need to have more faith so that you can believe with me. But I know that my day is not over.
That's right.
I know that God says I have eternal life.
Amen.
And so we believe together in standing in what God believes.
That's right.
And as we walk forward, we need to know that God has access for us. If we call out, it's going to take some intercession to get his promises on our behalf. We need to nullify the plans of the enemy. We need to stand in the gap. We need to surrender our expectations. Sometimes we expect what we want. You know, God, it's all about what I want. How about what he wants? Do you wake up in the morning and say, God, what can I do for you? God, what is it that you want me to do for you in the morning? Sometimes it's all about, God, what can you do for me? But how about if you get up and say, God, how can I serve you today? Put your hope in the Lord. Endurance takes exercise, guys. You know, I want sometimes to say, God, I want to be a great Christian. But we forget to worship. God, I want to be a great preacher, but you forget to pray. God, I want to be a great teacher, but you forget to read your word. God, I want to sing the song of the Lord, but you forget memorization of scripture. God, I want to be a great writer, but you don't pick up your pencil to write. God, I want to be a great counselor, but you forget to be kind. God, I want to be a great husband, a great wife, but you forget to serve. God, I want to be understanding, but you forget to listen. Align your purposes, yourself with purpose. God, how do I align myself with purpose if I don't have intent? Know what he has spoken over you. You got to know his word. You got to go back to those prophetic words. You got to stand on them. You got to look them up. If you don't know them, look in his word. It is the sure word of prophecy.
Come on, that's right. Amen.
Love him with all your heart. Move the obstructions that stand in your way.
Come on.
It says, move the obstructions that stand in your way. Jessica, can you give me that word? Move the obstructions that stand in your way. You know, we have to tell those mountains to move. We can't bow down to the obstructions that stand in our way. We say move, and it has to move. Utter his word and uplift others. Sometimes we're so worried about uplifting ourselves, we forget about loving our neighbor. You know, this time in the hospital, I said, you know what, this is not about me. We uplift others and we uplift what God has for us. We drive out negative mindset and we enlarge our territory. We need to reach out to what God has called for us. Reach up and reach out. You know, you want our church to grow? You want to grow? You got to reach out. If you want friends, you got to be friendly. You got to go to Publix. You got to be like, hey, ham and cheese barrel, what's your name? I got a church for you. Hey, deli guy, you with the chicken wings? I ain't asking you on a date, but I got a date with Jesus for you. Bring your girlfriend to church. Bring your mama to church.
Man.
You know what? I'm going to buy you an extra bucket of wings if you come to church tomorrow. It'll be on me. It's going to cost you something. It's it's going to cost you a cup of coffee. It's going to cost you maybe that you can't get that shirt because you have to treat somebody for a cup of coffee. The kingdom of God is going to cost us.
Amen.
Sometimes we don't want to pay the price to be friendly, but we got to reach up and reach out. Teach and testify. Heed and obey. What's the difference between heeding and obedience? Heeding is just listening. Obedience is the action. Allow God and let go. Never give up on the promises of God. If he has spoken a word over you, believe what he has said. Even in the times where it seems like the answer is no, dig deeper.
That's right. Yeah.
Dig deeper.
Yeah.
Dig deeper and fight for what God has given you. Walk by faith, by the word. Walk by the word and know that he is a lamp and a light. That his word is a lamp unto thy feet. And that word that's a lamp is not just for the light that's right in front of you, but there's a light that is for the long haul and a lamp that is for the short. Because he's going to illuminate the short path and the light that's for the long path. God's not going to leave you just for what's right now, but he has a plan for short term and a plan for long term. Overcome by the blood, access to forgiveness. You know what? When you have access to forgiveness, boy, I always tell people say, well, you need to forgive. Yes, I do. Because forgiveness is not for others. You know what? Forgiveness is for you. You know why? So you can choose to move on. So you can choose to move on to what God has for you. So you can carry others along the way. Because let me tell you something, baby. If you cannot love yourself, you can't love anybody else. But if you can love yourself, the Bible says what? Love your neighbor as you love yourself.
Yes, amen.
And if you can love others the way God has taught you to love yourself, this world will be a better place.
That's right.
Most of the people can't love others because they've never learned to love themselves. They can't forgive themselves of their wrong. They can't forgive themselves of their shortcomings. They can't let go of their abuse. They can't let go of the things that they've seen done wrong to them. They're angry. Anger has no place in the kingdom of God.
That's right.
Only righteousness, peace, joy, and the Holy Ghost. Yeah. Delight yourself in the Lord. Rest in the Lord. And surrender all of yourself. You know, so many times as Christians, we want to surrender just our sin. But God says, can you surrender everything?
Amen.
Can you surrender your joy? Can you surrender who you are? Can you surrender your talents, your ability, your song? Can you surrender everything?
That's right.
You know, when death stares you in the face, you want to surrender everything. And say, God, I don't want to just surrender what I'm not. I want to surrender it all. I want to surrender what I can't stand. I want to surrender all. All belongs to you, Jesus. Everything that I have my power, because I know that it's coming like the rain. I know that you're going to rain on my life. You're going to rain on my family. That you're coming like the rain to restore everything that the enemy has tried to steal. And you're coming again. I know. That he's coming like the rain.
Yes.
So if you have any doubt in your mind, Jael took with her hand a peg and drove it out, the thought of the enemy. I want to challenge you. Take your hand of worship and drive out the enemy. In your home, it's your job. She raised her hand with the word. Put it into your mindset. Put it into your home. Drive it out. Don't allow it to come in. Take your hand, raise them high, and drive out the thought of the enemy. It's our job as Christians. It's our job as servants of the Most High King. It's our job as servants. Lovers of Christ. Surrender everything. Not just pray. Thank you for letting me share with you today. I'm alive and well. The enemy has not had his way with